scientific historians. In other words, they're limited by the means by which they investigate historical events. We have not only what they have, but in the scriptures, we have divine revelation, which gives us often the sense that transcends the sense the historian may understand, because it comes from God with the interpretation which only the Lord God is able to give infallibly. This divine purpose, we pointed out in our last study that the Apostle Paul uses that very expression, the purpose of the ages. This divine purpose includes divine election, as we saw in Ephesians chapter 1 and verse 4 in the same book. It includes, as a matter of fact, all things that happen, because God works all things according to the counsel of his own will. If we had only the epistle to the Ephesians, we could say that much. So the purpose begins then and concludes ultimately in the glorification of the triune God. But so far as Scripture is concerned, Scripture begins with a great emphasis upon the creation of the universe, the creation of man, the creation of woman. And we looked at that last week. We don't really know how the creation took place. As a matter of fact, I'm not sure that it's possible for us as human beings to know that. We seek to find out, of course, how God did what he did. We know chapters 1 and 2. We know God spoke this universe into its existence. We know things like that, but the precise means which he used in order to do it, we don't know. They are not revealed in Scripture. Whether the Big Bang could be an adequate description of ways in which God may have accomplished his creation, or to put it in the terms of Calvin, the horrendous space kablooey, we don't know. We simply know Scripture, so far as we know, sets forth what the mind of God would have us understand about creation. But the details are beyond us, just as how the resurrection took place, the way in which God accomplished that scientific fact, we don't understand that. Well, tonight we're moving on to the next stage in our story, the fall of man. As we looked about us and looked at men, I think we would come to an understanding, if we thought long and hard about it, that there must have been something that happened in the past that is responsible for the condition of man today. Some time ago, I read a quotation of John Henry Newman, a person who had very significant historical impact and spiritual impact upon the Christian church some generations back. Speaking of the profound mystery of the human being in his condition, Newman said, "What shall be said to this heart-piercing, reason-bewildering fact?" He's talking about the condition of man. "I can only answer that either there is no creator, or this living society of men is in a true sense discarded from his presence. Did I see a boy of good make and mind with the tokens on him of a refined nature cast upon the world without provision, unable to say whence he came, his birthplace, or his family connections? I should conclude that there was some mystery connected with his history, and that he was one of whom, from one cause or another, his parents were ashamed. Thus only should I be able to account for the contrast between the promise and the condition of his being. And so I argue about the world. If there be a God, since there is a God, the human race is implicated in some terrible aboriginal calamity. It is out of joint with the purposes of its creator. This is a fact as true as the fact of its existence, and thus the doctrine of what is theologically called original sin becomes to me almost as certain as that the world exists and as the existence of God." A very simple but a very pointed argument. If we look at human history about us, it's obvious that something has happened since the Creator in heaven created the human race. Jim Packer, in one of his books entitled God's Words, Studies in Key Bible Themes, said, "You cannot understand yourself or your fellow men or the world you live in or the Christian faith, and you will not be able to make head or tail of the Bible. For the Bible is an exposition of God's answer to the problem of human sin. And unless you have that problem clearly before you, you will keep missing the point of what it says, apart from the first two chapters of Genesis, which set the stage. The real subject of every chapter of the Bible is what God does about our sins. Lose sight of this theme, and you lose your way in the Bible at once." That's really true. That's the reason why so many people open up the Bible and find it hard to understand. They've not an understanding of human sin. They've not an understanding of their sin. There is no sense within them of a need that exists because of their sin and the bondage that it brings to sin. And consequently, the Bible is something that they turn away from and often say, "I don't see how anyone can understand the Bible." Well, now let's turn to read a few passages. I'm going to talk for a few minutes about Adam and Eve's probation in the Garden of Eden, then the fall itself, and spend most of our time on the results of the fall this evening. Chapter 2, verse 15 through verse 17. And Moses writes, "Then the Lord God took the man and put him in the Garden of Eden to tend and keep it. And the Lord God commanded the man, saying, of every tree of the garden you may freely eat, but of the tree of the knowledge of good and evil you shall not eat, for in the day that you eat of it, you shall surely die." Now let's turn to chapter 3, beginning at verse 1. "Now the serpent was more cunning than any beast of the field which the Lord God had made. And he said to the woman, has God indeed said, you shall not eat of every tree of the garden? And the woman said to the serpent, we may eat of the fruit of the trees of the garden, but of the fruit of the tree which is in the midst of the garden, God has said, you shall not eat of it, nor shall you touch it, lest you die. Then the tempter said to the woman, you will not surely die. For God knows that in the day you eat of it, your eyes will be opened, and you will be like God, knowing good and evil. So when the woman saw that the tree was good for food, that it was pleasant to the eyes, and a tree desirable to make one wise, she took of its fruit and ate. She also gave to her husband with her, and he ate. Then the eyes of both of them were opened, and they knew that they were naked. And they sewed fig leaves together and made themselves coverings. And they heard the sound of the Lord God walking in the garden in the cool of the day. And Adam and his wife hid themselves from the presence of the Lord God among the trees of the garden. Then the Lord God called Adam and said to him, where are you? So he said, I heard your voice in the garden, and I was afraid because I was naked, and I hid myself. And he said, who told you that you were naked? Have you eaten of the tree of which I commanded you that you could not eat? Then the man said, the woman whom you gave to be with me, she gave me of the tree, and I ate. And the Lord God said to the woman, what is this you have done? The woman said, the serpent deceived me, and I ate. So the Lord God said to the serpent, because you have done this, you are cursed more than all cattle, and more than every beast of the field. On your belly you shall go, and you shall eat dust all the days of your life. And I will put enmity between you and the woman, and between your seed and her seed. He shall bruise your head, and you shall bruise his heel. To the woman he said, I will greatly multiply your sorrow and your conception. In pain you shall bring forth children. Your desire shall be for your husband, and he shall rule over you. And to Adam he said, because you have heeded the voice of your wife and have eaten of the tree of which I commanded you, saying, you shall not eat of it. Cursed is the ground for your sake. In toil you shall eat of it all the days of your life. Both thorns and thistles it shall bring forth for you, and you shall eat the herb of the field. And the sweat of your face you shall eat bread, till you return to the ground. For out of it you were taken, for dust you are, and to dust you shall return. When man was created, he was created in the image of God. He pointed that out. Rational, mortal, moral, I should say, and legal, given the command to rule over the earth. And so consequently, he had a magnificent beginning. He had, within the garden itself, every advantage as far as obedience was concerned, beautiful, with all of the things necessary for his needs, and only one thing that he was unable to do, and that was to eat of the fruit of the tree which is in the midst of the garden. In other words, his provision was a model of parental care from the Father in heaven. He was brought under a probationary command. We could call it a covenant because all of the aspects of a covenant are there. Historically, in theological literature, it's often been called the covenant of works, reference to the Garden of Eden. It's called in the Scofield Bible, for example, the Edenic covenant. Strictly speaking, the term covenant is used with reference to it in possibly one place in Hosea chapter 6 and verse 7, but that's a disputed text. I personally think it's a valid thing there. But nevertheless, it is a question that's not important for us at this point. At least we could say it was a probationary command that was given to Adam and to Eve. As I say, a gracious arrangement that laid the ground for another covenantal head, the last Adam, who is, in the final analysis, the only true, genuine tree of life. So Adam and Eve are in the garden that God created. That's the probation and the probationary command given in 2:15-17. The fall of man is described in chapter 3. And here we have the entrance of evil into this world. Not the entrance of evil in the sense of its existence in the universe. We know from other places that evil had already existed, and in chapter 3, verse 1, we read, now the serpent was more cunning than any beast of the field, an allusion, no doubt, to the sin of Satan before the creation of the universe, man and woman. So here is the entrance of evil into this world. And you learn, of course, right at the beginning that sin is an intruder. It's not good in the making, but it is an intruder into this human situation. What follows and is described in Genesis chapter 3 and verse 1 through verse 5 is the most disastrous dialogue in human history, initiated by Satan, about God and in the third person. I think that's so interesting. It's so interesting to me that when Satan comes on the scene, the discussion takes place in the third person. One gets the impression, I don't think I can prove this, but one gets the impression that God has already become someone with whom they don't have the most personal relationships that they should have. They can talk about him in the third person. It's almost as if Satan comes on the scene and suggests, what we need to have is a weekend seminar on God. And so they discuss the question of God and the personal relationship that Adam and Eve should have had with him and should have had built up as a significant experience of theirs apparently has left them. You know about the creation. We don't have time to deal with it. If you're interested in what I might say in more detail, you can go to the tapes on the book of Genesis or some of the tapes in systematic theology, which we dealt with these same topics on a little different level. Satan questions the Word of God, first of all, in verse 1 and verse 2 and 3. Has God indeed said, you shall not eat of every tree of the garden? Then he contradicts the word in verse 4. He says, you will not surely die, in direct contradiction of the word of God. That statement incidentally was aimed at genocide, but it is a statement that ultimately leads in its unraveling through the Old Testament and finally in the great act which will reverse what happened to theocide itself, because the Lord Jesus will ultimately die on the cross in order to deliver us from the effects of Satan's questioning and contradiction of the word and Adam and Eve's fall. He then, after having questioned the word, after having contradicted it, in verse 5, maligns the author. For God knows that in the day you eat of it, your eyes will be open and you will be like God, knowing good and evil. In other words, God's not really interested in the good things for you, but he wants to preserve things for himself and keep them from you. So he's questioned the word, he's contradicted the word of God, and now he has done a little bit of well poisoning, which so many of us immediately take to ourselves by saying things that suggest that God's really not for us. Think of the statement in Romans chapter 8, if God's before us, who can be against us? The scriptures speak plainly to the effect that God is for his people totally and completely, and history has borne it out. So Adam and Eve, mesmerized by the serpent, have listened to the creature rather than the creator. They've followed impressions, not instructions. They're seeking self-fulfillment, something that they feel now perhaps that God has restricted from them. They're not seeking his glory, and so they inclined to evil and finally sin. But notice this important thing. They are still religious. They haven't abandoned religion. They're still religious. They believe in a God. They know the person about whom Satan is talking. And so even though they still are religious, they have sinned. And the first and most catastrophic sin of all, they're guilty of. Our world thinks that if a person is religious, everything is all right with them. Just be religious. But how far that is from the truth of the Word of God. As a matter of fact, the Bible tells us that everybody is religious. We may deny that we are, but every one of us has an ultimate, which is the ultimate thing for which we're concerned. That's our religion. There's one thing that modern theology has underlined in its liberalism. It is the fact that even though we do not have the religion of the Bible, we all have an ultimate concern. And that ultimate concern is our God. That's what we're interested in. That's why the Bible speaks about things such as the love of money, the world, as being idolatry. They've become our God. So, Adam and Eve is still religious. And in the fall, there is the clue to the enigma of life. Look at our society, look at the society of any nation, look at the society of this world of which we are a part, and one will find that the clue to life is ultimately what happened in the Garden of Eden many hundreds of thousands of years ago. Read the front pages of your newspapers, read the analysis of the news, ultimately it will come to this fundamental fact, human sin. It's amazing. And nevertheless, it's true. Later on, I'm going to quote Herbert Butterfield. He was a professor of modern history for a number of years at the University of Cambridge, who wrote some significant literature that pertained to that, and in which some of his volumes are some very striking statements to underline just precisely what I'm saying. So I want to turn now to the results of the poll. It's difficult for modern man to recognize sin because, as Jim Packer says, it's uncomplimentary to him. He turns away from it. He doesn't like to discuss it. In fact, if you discuss it, you'll get angry with him and say all kinds of things about you. Might even call you a puritan or something like that. That's about the ultimate that the world can think of. They know the Puritans were bad, because they talked about the Word of God, and they talked about sin, and they talked about Jesus Christ. So it's difficult for modern man to recognize sin. Sin is seen best in the context of God's holiness. But there's a short supply of God's holiness today. It's very difficult to find it. And I find it in the presidential campaign. As a matter of fact, that's the one thing that the presidential candidates wouldn't like to talk about. Holiness. In fact, sin has become secularized. It's an offense against decency. Not an offense against God, but an offense against decency. An offense against a humanly erected standard, not an offense against the Word of God, not an offense against the Holy God, anything like that, but just an offense against the kind of life and the patterns of life that we think are, quote, good, unquote. Now, to summarize these consequences, I want to be a little theological, and I hope you'll follow me along, because these are very important for the rest of the Bible. And if we get these things, we'll understand the Bible a whole lot better. I'd like to suggest to you that in the first place, sin is disobedience of God. It's unbelief. Disobedience of God that leads to immorality, or immorality while sin is not the cause. Unbelief is the cause, and finally manifests itself, or I should say rebellion, and then manifests itself in immorality. The chain is unbelief, rebellion, immorality. You'll see that. We're not going to look at this in this short series of studies, 10 or 12 or so, but we see it in Genesis chapter 4. It's not long before the fall has taken place, rebellion follows, and then the immorality of murder. That's the pattern always. But the reason for sin is not selfishness. It's often said selfishness. There's a sense in which, of course, that's sin, and we lay stress on it. It surely is rebellion against God. But the fundamental reason is lack of trust in the divine revelation. So it's unbelief, rebellion, immorality. That's the pattern. If you'll bear that in mind, I think you'll understand what happens in our society. We have fundamentally the denial of the first of the Ten Commandments. Thou shalt have no other God before me. And then, of course, the second. And that is, we should not make any graven image. The same thing. So now, first of all, then, as a result of the fall, there is the imputation of Adam's sin to the race. Let's turn over to 1 Corinthians chapter 15 and verse 21 and 22. Then we'll also read Romans 5 and verse 21, verse 12. 1 Corinthians chapter 15 and verse 21 and 22. The apostle writes, "For since by man came death, by man also came the resurrection of the dead. For as in Adam all die, even so in Christ shall all be made alive. In Adam, all die. Now Romans chapter 5 and verse 12. What a great text the Apostle Paul wrote. Therefore, he says, Romans 5:12, just as through one man sin entered into the world and death through sin, and thus death spread to all men because all sin. How did all sin? We don't have time to discuss it, but I just suggest to you this. Happens to be my interpretation, that all sinned in Adam, in the sense that Adam was our covenantal head and stood for us. And so when our covenantal heads sinned, in whom we had stood in the mind of God, we had sinned. So by the gracious plan of federal headship, God works. We learn right there that the plan by which God is going to carry out his work of salvation is grounded in federal headship. What do we mean by federal headship? Federal might even throw you off these days because we lose confidence in the use of the term federal today because our federal government has not been always true to its principles. Federal is a term derived from the Latin term foedus. Foedus is the Latin term for covenant. So a federal government is a covenantal government. In other words, there are things that the government covenants to do, and there are things that men as citizens covenant to do. We have a federal government. The raging argument among both liberals and conservatives over the extent of the federalness of our government in our day, but that's the meaning. Now, when we talk about the sin of Adam, we're talking about Adam as a federal head. That is a covenantal head. He stands for the people of God. The Lord Jesus is a covenantal head. He stands, let me go back. Sometimes get a little excited over some of these points. But Adam stands as a covenantal head for the race. Our Lord stands as a covenantal head of the people of God. And so what we are taught then as a result of the fall in the Garden of Eden is that the sin of Adam is imputed, is reckoned to those for whom Adam stands. Those two chapters that we referred to, 1 Corinthians 15 and Romans chapter 5, spell out the details. If you want to know more about it, go back and read Romans 5, 12 through 21, and 1 Corinthians 15, 21, and following. So, by the gracious plan of a federal headship, God works. Without representation, the race might have perished forever. As a matter of fact, the race deserved to have perished forever there. But fortunately, God had, in his infinite wisdom, a federal head who was to come, the Lord Jesus Christ. Now, again, I say, if you're interested in more detail, there are 6 or 8 tapes in the series on anthropology that deal with these points in, I think, fairly good detail. But we have to assume this in this brief kind of study that we're doing now. But the point I want to make is that God has let us know right here that he deals with men covenantally. If we cannot sin in another, then we cannot be redeemed by another unless we have a different way by which God deals with men. When Adam sinned, men sinned. When Christ dies on Calvary's cross, those who are in him benefit by what he has done. So if we object to the covenantal relationship of Adam, our objection may be lodged against the covenantal relationship of the Lord Jesus Christ, if we do not think it is proper for God to deal this way. Incidentally, there is a message in the series on eight greatest things in the Word of God, or the eight greatest truths in the Word of God, in which I devoted one Sunday morning here an hour to the subject of representation and why it's the greatest way in which God could ever possibly deal with men. And if you have some questions about what I'm saying, you can go read that. The second thing that is a result of the fall is the inheritance then of original sin. In Ephesians chapter 2 and verse 3, the Apostle Paul refers to that. Ephesians chapter 2 and verse 3. The apostle writes, among whom also we all once conducted ourselves in the lusts of our flesh, fulfilling the desires of the flesh and of the mind, and were by nature children of wrath, just as others. So, the inheritance of original sin. What does original sin involve? Well, it involves guilt, liability to punishment. It involves pollution, because that's one of the effects of it. That's suggested, I think, or at least referred to in Psalm 10 and verse 4, where the psalmist says, in a fairly familiar verse, I'm sure it's made an impression upon you, are not wrong. They are inspired. The wicked in his proud countenance does not seek God. God is in none of his thoughts. So not only is guilt involved in sin, but also pollution and what we like to call total depravity, which refers to the pervasiveness of sin. John Gerstner has pointed out that total depravity refers to the corruption of the total human nature, not the total corruption of human nature. In other words, when the Bible speaks about total depravity, it does not mean that we're as bad as we possibly can be, but it does mean that all of our faculties are touched by sin. As Dr. Gerstner has said, total depravity refers to the corruption of the total human nature, our mind, our will, our emotions. Not the total corruption of our mind, our will, our emotions. Total depravity. C.S. Lewis didn't like the term. C.S. Lewis said in one of his books, he said, I don't believe in total depravity. And the reason I don't believe in total depravity is because if I were totally depraved, then I wouldn't understand my depravity. But the fact that these individuals speak about understanding their depravity means they're not totally depraved. Well, that was a clever remark, as you might expect, coming from C.S. Lewis. It only indicated that he hadn't taken much systematic theology, because the point of the doctrine of total depravity is not that we are as bad as we can be. There are many things we do understand. But sin has touched our mind, has touched our will, has touched our emotions. So, in spite of the clever remark, it's just simply not true. H.A. Ironside, who was a well-known Bible teacher of the last generation, used to refer in explaining total depravity to Joseph Cook, the great Boston lecturer of the left half of the 19th century, who gave this illustration of total depravity. He said he had in his home a very beautiful and valuable clock. It had an exceedingly handsome case, a very fine set of works, a nice appearing dial, and an elegantly finished hands. It was altogether a good clock to look upon, but it had one fault. It simply would not or could not keep time. It had been gone over by many different clockmakers, but no one had been able to correct this fault. Dr. Ironside used to say, as a timepiece, it was totally depraved. There were many beautiful things about it, but it just didn't keep time. And when we say we are totally depraved, we're not as bad as we can be. But all of our being is affected by the sin that is ours. Now, thirdly, the third thing that happened in the Garden of Eden was that man became exposed to spiritual inability. To put it in the language of the apostle, well, to put it in the language of the Lord Jesus first, in John chapter 6 and verse 44, the Lord Jesus makes a statement that is so important when you talk about spiritual inability. This is John chapter 6 and verse 44. The Lord Jesus says, "No one can come to me except the Father who sent me draws him, and I will raise him up at the last day." Romans chapter 8, verse 7 and 8, that also is said. In 1 Corinthians chapter 2 and verse 14, it is said with reference to the mind. The natural man receiveth not the things of the Spirit of God, their foolishness to him, neither can he know them, for they are spiritually discerned. So, no man, Jesus said, can come to me except the Father which hath sent me draw him. The problem with our wills is that while our wills are free, we are not. I like to use a different terminology, but I use that for the benefit of some who still like to retain the term free will. If free will means simply that you have a will. Augustine used free will in that term. He would say, we have a free will. But when he said we have a free will, he meant simply we have the faculty of the will. Now, when Augustine went on to talk about the effect of our nature on the decisions of life, he said our nature is such is that we always will that which is evil. Modern man likes to think of a free will as the will which has the power to decide either pro or con God of itself. And so free will is used in that sense, and that's why I often deny the existence of free will, thinking about that as the definition. Strictly speaking, our wills are free, but we are not. The will is moved by motives. It's a secondary power. And so our nature determines the way in which we will. Our nature is such, I like to play golf. And so I will, upon occasion, to play golf. That's the product of my desire. And then also I may have some intellectual desires, too. Because I like certain things intellectually, my desires are translated into acts of will. The will is the secondary agent, not the primary. And unfortunately, the primary disposition is that which is touched by evil. The natural man receiveth not the things of the Spirit of God, their foolishness to him, neither can he know them, for they are spiritually discerned. The will is moved by motives, as the church has always said. We think, you know, because we are so exposed to a society in which free will is glamorized and claimed, that the Christian church must be a body of people who also accept that, and individuals who go around like Johnson does are out of touch with the doctrines of the Christian church. So let me read you a few of the pronouncements of the Christian church. These are historic pronouncements. We'll go back to Luther. Luther said, if any man doth ascribe aught of salvation, even the very least of the free will of man, he knoweth nothing of grace, and he hath not learnt Jesus Christ aright. The great church confessions, listen to them. The 39 articles of the Anglican Church say, quote, the condition of man after the fall of Adam is such that he cannot turn and prepare himself by his own natural strength and good works to faith and calling upon God. That's the Anglican Church and their creed. The Book of Common Prayer. O Almighty God, who alone canst order the unruly wills and affections of sinful men. The Westminster Confession of Presbyterianism. Man, by his fall into sin, hath wholly lost all ability of will to any spiritual good accompanying salvation. So as a natural man, being altogether averse from the good and dead in sin, is not able of his own strength to convert himself or to prepare himself thereto. The London Confession of the Baptists reads precisely the same, those same words. The Reformed Belgic Confession. Are you getting the point? That when a person says, I don't believe in free will, he's following in the train of historic orthodoxy. Listen to the Belgic Confession, a Reformed Confession. Therefore, we reject all that is taught repugnant to this concerning the free will of man. Since man is but a slave to sin and can receive nothing except it have been given him from heaven. For who may presume to boast that he of himself can do any good, since Christ says, well, what do you know? They know John 6:44. No man can come unto me except the Father that sent me draw. You want to read George Whitefield, what he said? Well, it's the same thing. They all say the same thing. All of those in the tradition of the Reformation of the 16th century, and all the way back to Augustine, who said essentially the same thing. The person who talks about free will as if it's a Christian doctrine has not understood what the Bible teaches or what the Christian church has historically taught. I won't belabor it anymore for the sake of time. The fourth thing that took place as a result of Adam's sin was that man has been subjected to the penalty of physical and eternal death if he does not believe in Jesus Christ, but physical death and eternal death as a distinct future for man. 2 Thessalonians chapter 1 and verse 9 is one of the many passages that contains a text that bears on the point. The apostle is talking about the coming of our Lord Jesus, and he talks about those who do not obey the gospel of our Lord Jesus Christ. And in 2 Thessalonians chapter 1 and verse 9, he says, these shall be punished with everlasting destruction from the presence of the Lord and from the glory of his power. So as a result of the fall in the Garden of Eden, man has had Adam's sin imputed to him. We are born under the judgment of the sin of Adam in the Garden of Eden. We have original sin, a sin nature which we have inherited because of our status as those who had Adam's sin imputed to us. We have spiritual inability. We are unable of ourselves to turn to the Lord, and we are headed toward the experience of eternal wrath if the Lord Jesus and his salvation do not become ours. Does a loving God send men to hell? The answer of Scripture is strongly yes, a loving God does send sinners to hell. Hell is not a very pleasant place. Death itself is not a very pleasant place. Aristotle said death is a dreadful thing, or it's the end. Samuel Johnson says, a greater Samuel Johnson than the one you look at, Samuel Johnson says, no rational man can die without uneasy apprehension. John Donne, Christian poet, man of literature and Christian, said death is a bloody conflict and no victory at last, a tempestuous sea and no harbor at last, a slippery height and no footing, a desperate fall and no bottom. We live in the day in which it is popular to deny the final judgment. Julius Müller, who lived in the 19th century, he was nicknamed Sündenmüller, which means Sin's Müller, because he wrote a great big book on the Christian teaching of sin, the Christi Galera von der Sünde. He once wrote, no one is surer of applause than the man who discovers some new method of evading justice under the pretext of humanity. And we have this happening in Christian evangelical circles today. You know, I've lectured on John Stott and his attachment to conditional immortality, but he's not the only one, Clark Bennett and others. And in England and Britain, conditional immortality is the doctrine of a number of men who are evangelicals, who for a long time have not spoken of what they believe, but it has been hidden because it's still not popular with simple evangelicals who read the Bible. So, death, eternal death. One of the reasons, of course, that we die is simply that Adam and Eve took up a tree. Specifically Adam, because he was the federal head, and man fell in sin. Let me conclude with a few comments. The deepest division of men among men is that between those who know their sin and those who do not. It's a gift of divine grace to know this, and the Bible and the Spirit are the means to open our eyes. Sunday night in the Lord's Supper, I tried to say a few things about that, pointing out the external testimony of the Word of God to the truth of God. Anyone who reads the Bible and is open to divine truth will come to understand that the Bible is an authority. It communicates the note of authority, and it communicates also the note of advocacy or adequacy for our needs. But internally, it is the internal testimony of the Holy Spirit that gives light so that we are able, by God's grace, to turn from our sins to the knowledge of salvation. I mentioned Herbert Brotherfield Urzel earlier, and I'd like to read just a few things that Mr. Brotherfield has written. I highly regard this man. As I said, he was professor of modern history at the University of Cambridge for a long time, wrote a number of books, wrote specifically in the light of World War II, and wrote his books after World War II. And many of the things that he described in Christianity and history are things that arose out of the experience of World War II. Speaking of the sin of self-righteousness, Butterfield writes, in one fundamental sense, however, it seems to me that Christianity alone attacks the seed of evil in the kind of world we have been considering and has a solvent for the intellectual predicaments which arise in such a world. It addresses itself precisely to that crust of self-righteousness which by the nature of its teaching it has to dissolve before it can do anything else with man. How true that is. All of us are born in sin. And we live, and it's not long before we develop to the full this crust of self-righteousness in which we're not willing to look at ourselves in the light of God and His Word. That's what Mr. Butterfield is talking about. He also says some other things that I think are extremely good. He says, to me, therefore, it seems that nothing could be more exact, perhaps, for any man than the statement that all men are sinners and are the chief of them, or the thesis, there but for the grace of God go I. And I do not know why we ourselves should not be able to pray sometimes, Father, forgive them, for they know not what they do. All this seems to be the final effect of the reading of history upon me. There's a man who taught modern history in the highest circles of the scholarly world. This seems to be the final effect of the reading of history upon me. And if anybody answers me, I think there's a marvel statement here, if anybody answers me that of course there must have been great saints whom I'm slandering when I say they're all sinners, I accept the correction, but still note the fact that these great saints always seem to me to be the people who are most emphatically in agreement with me on the point I'm making. It's the great saints who talk about the fact that they're sinners. The historian cannot give a judgment on particular human beings that can be admitted as a final moral judgment on their personalities, save in the sense that he can say all men are sinners. The goal of Satan then in the Garden of Eden was to set up barriers to life. That's what he did in his little conversation that he had with Eve. And then in his activities in connection with Adam. And after the fall, he has sought to set up barriers to repentance and faith in Jesus Christ. Well, the rest of the story of the Bible, of course, is how Satan has a great deal of success, but how ultimately he fails in the end. In our next study, we're going to take up the flood, the Tower of Babel, and then come to the fundamental promises of the Bible, the promises to Abraham. So, if you want to follow along, and I think you'll get a whole lot more out of what I'm saying if you will do that, begin reading at Genesis chapter 4, and read on through Genesis chapter 7. And I think that next week in our study, you will perceive that I've become a great deal better teacher as a result of your having heard the text. Let's bow together. Father, we are grateful to thee for the unfolding of the reason why the world is as it is. How the fall touches all aspects of our life, personal, political, the intellectual life, the business life, all the life on the face of this globe affected by those events that are described in Genesis chapter 2 and 3. Oh, what an insight thou hast given us into the nature of man, the nature of God, and the nature of the appeal that the Godhead has made to us, to turn to our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ for deliverance from the judgments that lie upon us. Deep sin, original sin, spiritual inability, spiritual death at the present before we believe in Christ, all born into that state. And then if there is no turning to Him, ultimately, physical and eternal death. We thank you for the grace shown to us. We thank you for telling us, Lord, so plainly what we are naturally. And help us, Lord, also to be evangelists of the truth that thou hast made known to us. We know our responsibility. Help us to fulfill the marriage of honor for thy glory. In Jesus' name.